Carolina Cardenas Solaya. For talking about fully digital electronics implemented on Red Pitaya.
Good afternoon. So my name is Carolina Cardenas. I work in the National Institute of Meteorological Research, mainly on digital electronics for time and frequency applications. Today I will talk about the fully a project in which we are currently working on, that is the fully digital electronics for fiber link frequency transfer implemented on Red Pitaya. Optical clocks are currently available with an accuracy of the range in 10 and minus 18. These ultra-stable signals are exploited mainly in applications such as VLBI, radio astronomy, relativistic geodesy, and in the measurement of the verification of fundamental constants. Most of these applications are based on the comparison of two or more optical clocks that are currently or are in general not collocated. So a suitable medium for time or frequency transfer is required. The capability of the optical fiber links for reaching a frequency stability and uncertainty of the order of 10 and minus 19 has been demonstrated through different experiments. However, mechanical stress, temperature fluctuations, or environmental factors generate fiber length fluctuations that degenerate the stability of the frequency being transferred. So in order to compensate for this fiber noise, two techniques are in general applied: the Doppler, that is the traditional technique, and the two-wake, that is more recently applied. In the general scheme of the Doppler compensation, the two ultra-stable signals that are located in different laboratories are sent to the remote end through two parallel bidirectional fibers. Then the fiber noise is detected by comparing the transmitted signal with the return, the round trip that is returned back from the remote end. In order to distinguish this return signal from parasitic reflections, two acousto-optic modulators are added along the transmission path in the local and the remote sites. In this point, the bit node between the transmitted signal and the return signal is detected by photodetection, and the phase error could be actively compensated by acting on the frequency that drives the acousto-optic modulator in the local or in the remote end. In the case of the two-way technique, the signal is sent towards the remote user contemporaneously at both sites. So the comparison is based on a single trip of the signal. So for this case, the signal is only affected once by the noise of the fiber, while in the Doppler compensation, we found affected the signal twice the noise of the fiber. An additional phase and amplitude detector is added at both sites for monitoring purposes. So when implementing these techniques, three critical conditions should be taken into account: the detection bandwidth that should be wide enough in order to track the phase information before the coherence gets lost due to the noise. In current implementation, this detection bandwidth is around 100 kilohertz. That represents a limiting factor for long links or noisy links in general. Also, the photodetection generates additive noise that is revealed as excessive noise in the measurement. This is normally removed by reducing the detection bandwidth. So here, a finely tuning of the detection bandwidth could be advisable in order to guarantee an adequate signal-to-noise ratio for avoiding the generation of cycle sleeps. Finally, the polarization should be maintained aligned in order to avoid the degradation of the signal-to-noise ratio and consequently the generation of cycle sleeps. Currently, this is done through polarization control in order to guarantee the continuous operation. The traditional implementation is based on a tracking VCO that cleans up the photodetection noise and eventually amplification, and also a frequency divider that increases the dynamic range of the mixer. Afterward, a servo compensates for the fiber noise by acting on the frequency that drives the acoustoactive modulator. For monitoring purposes and for acquire the phase information, a phase meter is required. This kind of configuration have been demonstrated to work well. However, it has low flexibility and are not predisposed for efficient reconfiguration, monitoring, and remote operation. So we think on apply the advantages of the digital implementations that are mainly the reconfigurability and flexibility. In this implementation. So we plan to implement the compensation algorithm on the FPGA in order to reduce the latency between the different blocks and in this manner increase the bandwidth, the detection bandwidth. So the proposed system acquires directly the bit node that represents the fiber noise using a high-speed analog-to-digital converter followed by a fully digital phase detector. After that, a phase error could be compensated actively by acting on the frequency of a numerical controlled oscillator that acts on the acousto-optic modulator through a high-speed digital-to-analog converter. The entire system is clocked by a low noise reference through the internal PLL of the system. The proposed implementation is based on IQ detector. So we retrieve not only the phase but also the amplitude information that is used for feeding a simplex algorithm for perform the polarization control. Also, the bandwidth of the system could be finely tuned by changing the parameters of a low-pass filter chain. The system is implemented on Red Pitaya, that is an open source platform that integrates a 14-bit dual channel analog to digital converter working at 125 megahertz, a 14-bit dual channel digital to analog converter also working at 125 megahertz sample per second, and a system on chip that embeds a processor and an FPGA. The fully digital two-channel system is implemented using 16% of the FPGA resources. The system works in subsampling at 125 megahertz, so we remove the anti-aliasing filter predisposed in Red Pitaya because mainly our input signals are at 80 megahertz and higher. The system features a 10 megahertz detection bandwidth that is tunable down to 1 kilohertz. In order to verify the viability or the factibility of the implementation of the system, we first perform the characterization of the noise of the different components of the Red Pitaya the critical components that are the analog to digital converter and the digital to analog converter that are the interfaces with the analog signals, and also the PLL that will be the base for the system time base. So for doing that, we use the power spectral density and the Allan variance in order to evaluate the performance of these components at frequency close to the carrier. So based on this information, we observe that red pitaya will be limited by the noise of the PLL that is around 2 per 10 and minus 12 at 1 second. Based on this information, we estimate the noise contribution of the electronics for each technique. And so analyzing the frequency fluctuations of our signal. So thanks to the leverage between the RF and the optical frequencies, we expect a limitation around 10 per 10 and minus 18 at 1 second for the Doppler technique, and 6 per 10 and minus 19 at 1 second for the two waves technique. So the accuracy of the instrumentation will be more or less 100 times better that is needed. In order to verify all the features of the system and the correct performance of the instrument, we are currently working in the implementation of a fiber emulator that consists in a polarization controller and a fiber noise emulator. This is performed inside the FPGA in order to take advantage of the bandwidth of the SoC, of the system on chip, for analyzing mainly the features at long term. For instance, the generation of cycle sleeps that in current implementations are presented one cycle each 1 minute or 2 minutes. So this emulator could be activated or deactivated in that way that the simplex algorithm can act directly on an external polarization controller, and the action of this correction of the phase also drives directly the acousto-optic modulator. When the phase emulator is active, all the noise, the actions or simulation is performed internally. So the DAC output will be feeding the system, and we can emulate in that way a change in the fiber length or different types of noise that can affect our fiber and the frequency being transmitted. These are the very first preliminary results, that because our system has the capability of acquire different points of the chain. I mean, we can acquire the amplitude, the phase error, the phase correction, or the different outputs of the emulator. So these results were acquired by feeding the system with the output of the DAC in open loop and without any noise contribution. So we are analyzing these results, but we are expecting that these are the limitation of the instrument. So for concluding, we implement a digital instrument for the detection and compensation of the noise introduced by the fiber. It allows the implementation of the two schemes, the Doppler and the two-way, in closed and open loop, by only changing the parameters of the system. And in addition, it allows the implementation of the polarization control that is very useful for avoiding the cycle sleeps that are affecting or limiting the application in long links. The use of the internal PLL simplifies the system architecture since the anisternal synthesizer is not required. And also because the difference between the noise in the PLL and the converters, we have a 40 dBs of input dynamic. A fiber noise emulator is under development with the aim of studying the critical requirements like detection bandwidth, signal to noise ratio, depolarization under different scenarios. So different typologies of noise, like white noise or random walk, and different labels. Now we are interested in study deeper GNU Radio in order to implement in the near future the post-processing of the signals we are working on. So thank you for your attention.
Very much. Any question?
Whenever you were or you are working on the modulation schemes, you work at baseband because the RedPTi is working at baseband. Have you investigated what would be the So you show that the limitation is obviously the PLL, increased by a factor of 10, and the PL and the clock is coming from the PLL of the zinc. Mm-hmm. Now, with the newer chips that we're seeing from analog device, they have a different clocking scheme because they will generate their own PLL. Have you had a look at some of these frequency transposition chips as opposed to working directly at baseband?
No, I don't see that yet. But also this, because this scheme will take as reference a low noise clock. So, but yes, maybe it will be a good idea. So I will check it out.
I'm curious to know what is the PLL performance of these new chips. I mean, zinc is obviously not a radio frequency chip. Mm. Here we're talking about radio frequency dedicated chips. So,
Okay.
In the past, we did some investigation about residual noise of frequency multiplication. So what we have seen is that if you use the PLL that is embedded into an FPGA, basically they introduce a short-term degradation of the order of 10 to the minus 12 at 1 second. We also characterized the internal PLL of DDS, for example, the 9912 from analog devices. And in that case, the residual noise of the PLL is about 10 times better. So what we expect, we can, now we have a demo board, we will measure it, and we will characterize it by using the same methodologies. But what we expect is to get a similar result with respect to the AD 9912. Yes, and if you use a direct clock with that DDS, you gain an additional factor 10 improvement. So you can range from 10 to the minus 12 at 1 second to 10 to the minus 13 with a better multiplier, and to 10 to the minus 14 at 1 second with the direct clock. But in this case, so we knew that 10 to the minus 12 can be improved, but for FiberLink, there is a leverage of a factor of 1 million that reduces this contribution by such factor. As you have seen, the contribution of the RedPTi was about 10 to the minus 18 at 1 second. And the best optical clocks are at 10 to the minus 18 at 10,000 seconds. So we have about a factor 100 of margin. So, but there are other applications, especially the one in radio frequency, where the residual noise of the PLL is very important, and so we are curious to see what's the level of the new chip.
Thank you, Claudio.
Other question?
On slide 18, do you understand the peaks in your plot?
Here, yes. Not yet. We are currently analyzing it, but because here we are working in common mode with the clock of the system, so we think there is not the PLL that introduced this peak, so, but no, we are just analyzing currently the data.
Thanks.